Hi guys, DC Breaks here on the DBS Institute YouTube channel. In this video, which is the first part of a mini-series all about how AI can help us with audio mixing, I'm going to be looking at iZotope's flagship complete mixing suite, Neutron 4. So without further ado, let's jump on in. So Neutron 4 is iZotope's complete mixing suite. It does have an element of AI technology built into it through the new assistant view. And the way that this works is that you can now play audio through it. It will listen to it, analyze it, and then try and tone match to a reference target. We'll see how that works in a bit more detail later. There's also a few other neat functions that we'll look at that have been introduced for this particular version. It's available now on a 10-day free trial if you want to go ahead and download it. And likewise, I'm using a multi-track project from the Telefunken website that you can also download if you want to also have a go at mixing. If you go to the audio and video section, there's a section for multi-tracks here, and I'm going to be using this today on a recording of Sarah Elizabeth Charles at Platinum Sound Studios. And for each of the multi-tracks, there's a description of the session, how it was recorded, some of the gear that was used. And I chose this particular one because, as you'll hear, it's a live recording, so there's quite a lot of other technical issues that you're going to need to know about from a sort of mixing perspective, which I want to kind of put through Neutron and really kind of put Neutron through its paces to see how it actually handles this type of mix project. So you just click the download audio files if you want to go ahead and work along with this. So all I've done to start with here in Logic is to group all the stems into their relevant groups. So for example, I've got a folder for the drums, and within the drums there's a section for example, the room drums, which sound like this. If I hit solo. As well as kind of individual parts. So I've got a folder for the toms, likewise the vocals, bass, keys, guitar, and so on. And so you can use Neutron really on individual stems, on groups, or even on the master bus. But I'm going to start off by using it to process the kick layer. And so the way it works is it will start by giving you this detailed view, but I really want to come into this AI assistant view, solo the track, and then hit play so that it can listen to and get a feel for what it is that we're actually going to be mixing. So it's actually mistakenly thought of this as a whole drum bus, probably because of some of the of the microphone picking up some of the other instruments in the background there. So I actually want to set this to kick. And the way this is now going to work is that it's going to tone match our input signal to a reference signal. So if I slide this tone match slider all the way to zero, we're going to have just our original signal. And as I increase the tone match amount, it's going to start matching that profile to the profile of our reference input. And you can hear it becomes a lot more weighted to the low end as you'd associate with a kick. So where this gets interesting is that you can then create your own custom instrument targets. So for example, I've just pulled in one of a live kick, and I can use this live kick for mixing this live kick. And you might have seen and heard it has a slightly different profile to the sort of default one, if you like, as represented on this curve here. So within this sort of assistant view as well, we then get these kind of macro controls, and these allow us to dial in certain processing quickly, but these relate to more detailed settings that we'll look at in the detailed view in just a moment. But the idea is that we can use these to quickly shape the tone of whatever it is that we're mixing. So for example, we've got this punch control here. You can hear how that obviously affects the punch. And there's some shaping as well through the attack control and sustain. And this type of effect is actually more of an old school hardware compression type of effect rather than a multi-band sort of transient shaper or anything like that. We've then got this distort module, which allows us to dial in harmonic saturation and distortion in four different styles. So retro, tape, tube, and warm, and we can kind of blend between these as well. And there's also a tone control here to adjust how much of the signal is sort of shaping our tone. And then there's a sort of a master control here that increases the amount of distortion that's being applied. So let's give that a go. There's also a more intense trash mode as well, which won't really be appropriate for this kind of music, but could be interesting in some sort of heavier genres as well. And then finally, a width control. And as I said, these relate to some of the controls under the hood in the detailed view. So for example, if I turn off the punch module, you can see it's now turned off this compressor. And if I turn off the distort module, that's turned off the exciter. So within the detailed view, we can add a number of different modules across the top in order. We've got two types of compressor, or two instances of compressor. We can choose how these, what the settings are in each of these individually. Equalizer, exciter, gate, sculptor, transient shaper, and this new unmask tool, which we'll look at in just a moment. And then we can kind of drag these around. So if you're not necessarily a really experienced mix engineer, you can use this to quickly dial in some settings. So for example, I might want to just come into the first compressor here and choose a kick drum setting. And then maybe for my second one, you know, something slightly different. I'm just going to pick something out of at random here. And likewise with exciter and other modules as well. So again, if you're not very experienced, or even if you are, this can be a quick way of improving your mixing by using presets and then kind of very easily being able to control the mix of these and also the kind of processing that's gone on. Now, within each of these as well, there's often this learn function here. So for example, if I dial in an EQ, I can have it listen and learn the input signal and adjust the frequency values of the EQ bands. So let's have a go at doing that. So this is just how the default is. If I hit learn. So it's picked out obviously the main sort of fundamental frequency of our kick. So this can help save time as well. And then also perhaps the, third harmonic, this one here as well, which might be something that we need to attenuate and boost. And it can do this for anything that we're running through it. So if it's a vocal, for example, that might it might help pick out some resonant frequencies that we need to maybe attenuate with some dynamic EQ, for example. So again, this can help speed up our workflow. Let's take a look at the unmasking module. So the way this works, if we, for example, have our bass down here. Let's go a bit further on where the bass is playing. Now, a common issue with mixing bass or any track where there's a kick and a bass is that the kick and the bass often occupy the same frequency range, and that can reduce the clarity and the punch of your low end by having too many muddy frequencies in the same range. So we can unmask these two things by coming to the unmask module. Coming into, for example, the bass and kick preset, you can see it says use on the bass to unmask the kick drum in this particular preset. And so all I need to do then now is use the sidechain to route in signal from our kick. And I'm just going to start by putting it on a really extreme setting, but bringing the mix down so you can hear what happens as I bring this up. So you should be able to hear there the bass really kind of pumping and ducking out the way when the frequencies from the kick are fed into it as well. And we can control you know, the sensitivity of that, the amount. Obviously I was using a very extreme amount, which wouldn't be appropriate for this genre. And then the attack and release settings of how quickly that sort of dynamic unmasking effect is being processed. So this is a great way of improving the separation between competing elements in a mix. And you could use this to help unmask vocals from guitars, kicks from basses, and all sorts of other elements within your mix. Hey guys, I hope you're enjoying the content. Just to let you know that we offer online courses in a range of creative subjects. So if you're interested in taking your skills and knowledge to the next level, check out the link below. So the next feature I want to look at with Neutron 4 is the visual mixer. And so what this has in it is a mix assistant, and we get this visual representation of our mix, which is quite an interesting way, or a different way of kind of looking at and working with a mix. So we've got our individual channels wherever we have an instance of Neutron throughout our project, and we can kind of turn these on and off We can move them around within the stereo image, left and right, if they're a stereo channel, and we can move them up and down in gain. So we can kind of quite quickly sort of experiment with different levels in the mix, like so. But really where it comes into its own is using the mix assistant. So the way this works is that it will basically pick up any instance of Neutron or another iZotope plugin called Relay within our project. We can choose which ones we want to use. For best results, it does recommend just using either all individual stems or all groups. So I'm just going to use groups in this case. You can pick a focus, for example, it might be the vocals, and then you just need to play the whole track through. In the interest of time, I'll skip through that, and then it will give you a recommendation. Clap your hands if you want to. So once it's finished listening back, it will then set up a mix accordingly. And if you're happy with these, you can then hit accept and it will send those levels back to Neutron and set up your mix. So let's just have a listen and see what we think it's done. Okay, so from here, one of the great things I can do is to hit plus, create a snapshot of that mix. I can then experiment by bringing, let's say, the drums up, maybe making them a bit more mono, bringing the vocals down. I've got some of my individual stems back in the project now as well, so I could, so for example, this one is the snare. I could make that really mono, put that a bit quieter. Maybe bring the, which this one is the kick, you know, maybe bring the kick really loud, whatever it is, and, you know, listen to that, and you can kind of do it as the track's playing, of course, and then hit plus to create another snapshot, and then you can kind of A-B between different snapshots to see which you think actually sounds best. And that's quite a quick way of getting the overall levels right between all the different elements in your mix. So there's quite a few different powerful AI or AI-ish, I should say, tools. I don't really know what the AI is doing necessarily. They don't sort of talk about that on the iZotope website, but nevertheless, it is, I guess, in some way, an artificial intelligence, not in the sense of a neural network or machine learning or any of that AI stuff that we think of today, but nevertheless, it is assisting you and helping you to get a better result faster than perhaps you might otherwise be able to do if you were just setting up a mix completely manually. So that was a quick look at some of the AI-powered mixing tools within iZotope's Neutron 4. Let me know what we think in the comments below, and don't forget to hit that like and subscribe to get more videos like this delivered straight to your inbox from us here at the DBS Institute. But that's it for this video, and I'll see you in the next one.